Nas Talk given by Dr. Lesniewski, optical properties of something which looks very complicated, fluoride doped with manganese 4 plus at ambient conditions and high pressure.
Thank you very much. My name is Tadeusz Leśniewski. I will be talking about optical properties of potassium hexafluoride silica germanates. As you said, the name is quite a mouthful, so I use abbreviation like KSF or KGF instead. They are all doped with manganese 4+, and I will talk about their optical properties and the impact of high pressure on this group of crystals. The outline of my presentation is the following. I will present a brief motivation. I will talk about structure and the relation between structure and optical properties of KSGF crystals doped with manganese 4+. Then I will switch to high pressure spectroscopy, and I will talk about the change of optical properties of KSGF under high pressure. Do you hear me well? Okay. So the full formula for our compound group is written at the top. We have investigated a whole series of samples where, as you can see, we gradually replace silicon bar by germanium. Those compounds are member of fluoride phosphorus groups, the ones that have been presented also in the last presentation. And there are all red phosphors and are intended to be used for improving the color rendering index of warm white LEDs. So the interesting thing about this group of compounds is that depending on the silicon to germanium ratio in the composition of the crystal, we can get three distinct crystal structures. So we start with cubic for pure KSF. Then we go from through transient hexagonal crystal structure to a different variant of hexagonal for pure KGF. The manganese 4+ is incorporated into the silicon or germanium 4+ site and is coordinated by fluorine ions. And the local symmetry of the manganese site depends on the crystal structure. So it is either OH for the cubic, C3 symmetry, or D3D symmetry for pure KGF. One of the goals of our investigation was to check whether we can obtain similar changes in crystal structure, instead of changing the composition just by inducing some changes by pressure. Now, a quick glance at photoluminescence, excitation, and emission spectra. The interesting thing is that even though the crystal structures of those compounds may be quite different, the PLE and PL spectra are always very similar. So we have two broadband excitation bands roughly at the same spectral region, and we have several narrow emission of several narrow lines. And the only impact of the structure is that depending on the local site symmetry of manganese 4+, we either get or do not get a zero phonon line. So this is two representative examples of pure KGF and mixed germanium-rich crystal, where for lower symmetry we get zero phonon line, and for higher symmetry we do not get zero phonon line. Now, how can we relate this to those transitions to electronic structure of manganese 4+, where of course we should use the Tanabe-Sugano diagrams, which relate the energies of electronic states of transition metal ions, this is a D3 ion, to a few parameters. This diagram takes into account mostly the interaction with the environment for this. For us, it would be fluorine ions by means of a so-called a crystal field strength parameter dq. And as you can see, as the crystal field strength increases, the energies of the states are changing, and those two excitation bands are related to the transition from 4A to ground state to two lowest spin quartets, quartet states, 4T1 and 4T2. Those are spin allowed transitions, of, as I said. They are strongly electron lattice coupled, so they are broad and have a quite significantly probability of transition. And of course, the energy, as can be seen from the Tanabe-Sugano diagram, is dependent on the dq crystal field strength parameter from the slope of the curves. Now, the emitting state in manganese 4 plus is always the 2E state, which means that we are somewhere over here in the Tanabe-Sugano diagram, above this cross section. The transition is parity forbidden, also spin forbidden, so it has long decay times, and is possible mostly due to either phonons, as we can see from the emission spectra, or odd crystal field components, where we can get zero phononine. Now, there were people talking about high pressure generation, so I will skip this. I will just remind you that we use diamond anvil cells to squeeze the our samples inside the pressure chamber, and we can get significant pressures in the range of, for example, 50 kilobars or something. Now, high pressure results. Here we can see the high pressure shift of photoluminescence and photoluminescence excitation spectra, this time in the energy scale. And what should we expect from the basic approximate model? When we apply pressure, the energies of 4T1 and 4T2 state should increase. Why? Because when we decrease the interatomic distances, we assume that we change the crystal field strength interaction. And on the other hand, there should be no real difference in the emission spectra. This is not exactly the case. We see quite strong shifts, spectral shifts of 4T1 and 4T2 states, but we also have quite noticeable change in the 2E emitting state. Well, this, of course, is a result that the assumption that there are no other difference than increasing the crystal field strength parameter is not true. So we have performed some basic calculations of crystal field parameters, and we have in fact discovered that besides that dq crystal field strength parameter is changing quite a lot for every sample, we also, for example, found out that the Racah parameter B, so-called Racah parameter B, which describes the interaction between the D3 electrons in manganese 4 plus, is also changed. Now, as I said, we have been also trying to find any evidence of phase transitions in the KSGF mixed crystals by means of optical spectroscopy. So we have been trying to find some changes in optical spectra after applying pressure. And this is a representative example. We have a silicon-rich mixed crystal, and at certain pressure, here 8 kilobar, we see that zero phononine appears. So this would be an indication of some sort of crystal structure change. This change is permanent because we have a result of the emission spectrum after decompression, and the zero phononine is still present. Now, this is the emission spectra for all of our samples measured. We start from pure KSF at the top and go to pure KGF at the bottom. We see that depending on the crystal symmetry, we either have zero phononine to start with, where we do not have inversion symmetry in our manganese 4 plus site, or we do not have zero phononine. Now, when we put also our data after the compressing the sample and decompressing back to ambient pressure, we see that there are several changes. For example, for silicon-rich samples where we had, didn't have the zero phonon line, the zero phonon line emerges. There are some samples unaffected, like pure KGF or this mixed KSGF. But also we have one sample where the zero phonon line that was present actually disappeared. Okay, and this of course was a strong suggestion that there are phase transition induced by pressure. But to confirm this, we had to perform some sort of other measurements. So we chose Raman spectroscopy, and here we have the initial Raman spectra of our samples. For analysis, we have focused on the new one, all symmetric stretch mode, Raman mode of the silicon fluoride octahedra, because that's what we see over here. And when we put also the spectra after compression decompression cycle, actually we think we do not see any significant changes. So the bottom line is that there actually isn't a phase transition as such, but the change in emission spectra is related just to a local change of manganese for price site without changing the rest of the crystal. So that we can, for example, think that for these two samples, the local symmetry of manganese 4 plus was deteriorating, so it's broken. But more interestingly is a fact that by applying pressure, we have, for this sample, we have increased the local symmetry of the dopant, which is a little less intuitive result. And our conclusions, as I said, pressure induces spectral shifts of our excitation emission spectra. That can be only approximately explained as an increase of crystal field strength parameter. More accurate descriptions require also the other parameters that are present in this theory. And also the application of pressure causes local alterations of manganese 4 plus site without phase transitions. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So, question over there.
Okay, so I have a question and a comment. First of all, I imagine when you apply the pressure, the two broad bands which do depend on 10dQ are both much more sensitive than the narrow band, let's say.
That's
so it's quite similar to what happens to Ruby and to Chromium 3 plus was. Well, the comment is the following. Normally, when you consider a D3 ion or another ion, normally you can use, in order to calculate the Rucker parameter B, the difference between the 41 and 42 bands, and also you can use the narrow band, the 2TE. Mm-hmm. You will see that normally you don't get the same value. So we have pointed out in two recent papers that one has to pay attention that when normally people uses the Tanabe-Sugano diagram, but there is an approximation. If you look, for instance, simply to a complex, like in your case, or in chromium, no, formed by the ion and six anions in cubic symmetry, you have 10 parameters. If you do the theory, 10 parameters, not two. Normally it is reduced because otherwise it's difficult to see, but at the moment that you do the things properly, you realize that you can explain the difference I have mentioned at the end.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so I would propose to stop discussion here somewhat late. Let's thank to the speaker and all the speakers again.